I would like to say a word about Pierre Alexandre now. welcome. Thank you for welcoming me. I'm very happy to be here. It's I feel privileged to have been invited to spend 2 weeks in your studios. As you probably know, at some point in life, you take too much responsibility in university, and then you have less and less and less time to compose, which is exactly what happened to me for the last 3 or 4 years. So the only way to do things like that, which I was hired at first for, is to escape from home and to be abroad and pretend not to respond to any of my emails, despite the pile. So I'm very happy to be here. I've seen this building under construction, actually, because between 2005 and now, I've been here another time. And the building was under construction, so I'm very happy to finally see what was the idea at the time. And I think it is fantastic. Pretty lucky. We are actually having a very nice plan of the new music faculty at the University of Montreal. That I will probably won't see on my living time. But the plan is absolutely gorgeous. You have to know that we are in a fantastic location, Montreal, but the building is quite old. So we're trying to fix it bit by bit. Still. So, pretty lucky you have the new building. So I would just introduce, essentially, we'll introduce pieces that I will present on the concert Saturday, and I will introduce also the idea that was behind a whole cycle of works that I was working for the last 14, 15 years, something like that. And so essentially this is it. And I think that the best thing is to come to the concert, because these pieces are intended for concert presentation, especially for stereo diffusion, but I will talk a bit about that later. So the cycle is called timbre spatialization. I will introduce the concept in a moment. So far, it includes 7 works, and the work I'm working on at the moment, which was started last summer, will be part of it, of this cycle also. So all these works. On the concert, if I remember well, I will play Eden, and I will play Anadliade and La Part des Anges on the concert on Saturday. So I'm making reference to Marshall McLuhan that probably some of you knows. Marshall McLuhan was a was a media communicator, thinker, philosopher, Canadian. And in 64, he wrote his famous book, Understanding Media, where he wrote, the medium is the message. And I was trying to understand, actually, this book and this sentence, which is not an easy thing. And it is a very funny thing, because at the very beginning, there was a typo in the title of the sentence, the medium is the message. And Marshall McLuhan has a very specific kind of humor, sense of humor, so he decided to let it there, you know, to make no correction about it. So, Space of the Sound, maybe these things will be a little bit obvious for you. Just want to double check something, sorry about that. Space of the Sound. So you know probably these things. When you have a look at the history of music, classical music in general, you would find some examples where space at some point was used in a specific ways, specific way by different composers. I just quote a couple of them because my goal here to make a whole survey of that. But if you think about Gabriel Lee, who was presenting his music in the Saint-Marc de Venise Cathedral in Venice, where he put two different choirs and opposed them, just like as a big stereo effect. Berlioz. Berlioz was probably more interesting to some point because he did try a lot of different experiments with placement of musicians in different locations. If you think about the way he was using the trombone player in the Requiem in Les Invalides, which is a big, big church in Paris where the piece was created, he put the trombone player far away in the corridor somewhere, and this trombone player was playing the call of the death, you know, from the hell, coming from the hell somewhere. So it was directly related to the content of the music and to the content of the program of the music. But if you think about it, these music, you can listen to them in stereo at home, you won't lose anything. You can even listen to them in mono, if you like, you won't lose anything, because the space was not really something that interfered with the writing of the notes, the duration, and the instrumentation of the works. So all the other parameters were so predominant that space was just essentially a flavor. Very good for people who were there, but for the contemporary listeners, it doesn't make any difference from my point of view. In electroacoustic music, and I will go very rapidly on that because you all know that, Michel Chion wrote an article in 1988 where he described the internal and the external space. First one is the one that the composer put in his music. And it could be done by different effects, whatever. And the second one is, and so this thing, the first, the internal space is fixed, and it is part of the work. Second one is when the piece is played in concert. The external space is influenced by the type of concert hall, it is influenced by the type of speakers, number of speakers, etc., etc. Okay? So I put these two images side by side because I think it reflects a different perspective on how you place speakers and what do you do with the show of the speakers. At the GRM, they really made a show of the speakers. It was obvious, they put lights on every single speaker to light them. This is a concert series, Pierre-Alexandre was talking about that. It was a concert series called Rien à voir. It was after your time. But Pierre-Alexandre and a group of students at the time took part of this concert series and they built it essentially with us. But at this period of the series lasts for 7 years. Rien à voir series, Rien à voir is nothing to look at. But there was something to look at, but no speakers. Everything but speakers. So we hired light designer essentially to build something within the room, but as you can see, there was, I don't know, 40 speakers in that room, and you don't see any of that. Okay, so this was the idea. So different philosophy about speakers. Also, in the 60s, and this is also something that you all know about, I think that essentially most of the instrumental music composers did experiment with instrument location. This is the representation of two pieces by Stockhausen, Gruben with three orchestra, public is here, three orchestra, and Gary where we have four orchestra surrounding the audience. And I think everybody at the time did that. Regina Xenakis, all these people, Boulez, they all did that kind of stuff. Okay, surrounding or putting musician, walking musician into the space, etc. So, electroacoustic music so far, is not that original in its concern about space. something exists in the acousmatic medium, and yeah, maybe I should have said that, but you mentioned it. I'm an acousmatic composer. I'm not an instrumental composer. I did a couple of pieces, but essentially I define myself as an acousmatic composer, which means that essentially I'm interested in writing sounds. If this gesture would work, it would be fantastic. Just writing words, writing sounds, wow, fantastic. Unfortunately, we have to go through a lot of machines and different gears that are not exactly efficient, I would say. So, yes, so what's going on with acousmatic medium, it is what is specific to acousmatic, it is its virtuality. And so the sound and the projection source are not linked together, which seems absolutely obvious, of course. But if you think about it a bit more, it allows us a lot of flexibility in terms of what and where we project sound into concert hall. Because if you think about instrumental music, even if you are interested in space and you put a violin somewhere in front or in the back, or trumpet, whatever, wherever it is still the whole timbre of the instrument that is placed behind you, or the trumpet in front, or the drum on the side, etc. It's the whole timbre of the instrument. Where in acousmatic music we can fragment the sound into different registers, into different parts, and put it from different sound sources. So this is what I mean by there's no link between the sound and the projection source. You can project with the speaker whatever you put in. And there is no necessity to have a real thing behind the speaker, like a performer. So it is possible to fragment the sound into the space, which is a completely different experience, as you can imagine, with instrumental music. This is an image. I will talk a little bit about that later, if we have time and if you are interested. This is a representation of the first version of the Zirconium, a software developed in Germany to manage the sound into a dome of speakers. And this is what I call timbre spatialization. The whole spectra of complex sound is fragmented in small parts, and it is sent to different speakers in the concert hall. So every speaker sends something different, usually it moves also, even slightly. And so the whole spectra is recombined within the concert hall, within the acoustic of the concert hall. And very curiously, first experiment I did with that, everything you know about sound tend to tell you that if you do something like that, because you break the phase of the signal, of the different component of complex sound, because you introduce delays and phase shifting and whatever, everything we know about the perception of complex timbre tells us that you won't recognize the source, because all these phase relationships will be broken, and then you will just hear all the separate components and they will not merge anymore. Okay? But my experience says exactly the opposite. Curious. So apparently we are pretty strong on recombining things that has to be recombined. So it's quite an interesting thing. Also, this is something that I really care for and I'm really into that. And we have developed tools to make sure that it is possible. To me, the composition of the space is not the flavor that you add at the end of the process, like it is very often the case, because most of the tools that are available needs that you have compose the piece before and then you specialize it, which makes no sense to me, because if I think about the space, I need to think about the space on a regular basis, on a daily basis. I would say I need to compose the timeline at the same time that I compose the spaces. It is just like, okay, I will think only about pitches today. No duration, no timbre, no nothing, just pitches. And then in 6 months, I will add duration. Okay? And then 6 months later, I will add timbres, and etc. So to me, composing like that with the space makes absolutely no sense. And the example I give always to my students is that just think about a very simple gesture. If you have 8 speakers and you just make the sound turning this way, it makes sense if you have 8 speakers. Because, you know, the sound, you perceive this sound differently at every single moment. So you are always triggered. Your attention is always triggered by the fact that the sound is moving and your ears is filtering the sound, the back, etc., etc. If you listen to that in stereo or in mono, it makes absolutely no sense. So some gestures make sense, musically speaking, only when you are into the situation of the multi-channel and the space of the concert, if I can say. So you have to be into it at every moment. And then you will compose gestures, musical gestures, that make sense on the spatial point of view, the spatialization. Unfortunately, there is a point about that, is that it is difficult to downsize these music. It is almost impossible to reduce multi-channel pieces into, well, let's say, commercial format. So I think that this way of working with the space is something that is absolutely exclusive to the acousmatic music. And then coming back to the title of the presentation, the medium is space. It is something that we can do only in acousmatic music. It is a very specific thing that belongs exclusively to acousmatic music. And I think it's quite interesting. Multi-channel work, I start multi-channel work long before I was interested in timbre specialization and stuff like that. There are a couple of things that were interesting or triggered me. Pierre-Alexandre talked about the time I was teaching acoustic and psychoacoustic and all that stuff at the University of Montreal. One of the things that we know is that if a speaker has less to do, he will do it better, first thing. Okay, so even if you put all the speakers in front of you, you can put many tracks in many speakers and it will be a lot better than to have only two speakers. This is for sure. Okay. It's an acoustic law, if I can say. Second thing, which is probably more interesting, is that, and I'm really sorry to remind you that we are mammals. We are also intellectual, but we are also mammals. And because of that, our sense of localization is very good. Because it comes from the time when it was absolutely crucial to survive, to exactly know where the lion is coming from. Okay? And we are still very good at that. Okay? We have lost some possibility, the fact that we don't move up over here, for example. It would be very interesting in concert. But you can move your head, at least. Okay. But we are very good on that, and because we are very good on that, and especially on the plan level, at the level of our ears, we are, especially in the front, but also kind of in the back, there's a lot less masking effects when the sounds are coming from different locations. If you put the same two sounds together, getting out from the same speaker, you get a lot of masking effects. We all know that. If they are within the same whatever register, amplitude, etc. But if you split them in two speakers located at different places, then suddenly, whoop, you hear them very clearly. So just imagine 16, 32, 64, 100 and something. Okay? So it means that you can, the polyphony of the music could be a lot more complex if you put different speakers in different locations in the concert hall, just because of that, just because of this very simple rule of perception. So it was interesting. So start a bit of the presentation of the work that I will present, and I will just try to explain how I work and what was the different strategy adopted over the last few years. So the first piece I will talk about is called Analiad. It was commissioned by Bangor University. It's a bit more complicated than that, but let's say that. The word is a Welsh word, it means breath, but also at the same time, inspiration, the one that inspired the artist. Okay, so it's a nice word because it has the strict sense of breath, inspiration, expiration, and also inspiration that the notion that we live with artists. So the sound, the piece is made out of two sounds, two recordings, two short recordings, Scottish bagpipe at first, and pipgorn, which is a Welsh instrument that you will hear in a moment, a very nice and tender instrument. You'll see in a moment. So this is the two instruments I was working on that made the structure, the basic structure of the work. And then I have added to that, because when I was there for a residency for 2 weeks. We had rainstorm every single day. The wind was absolutely fantastic, but quite heavy, I have to say. So I tried to put that into the music. I like to get to put some signature, sound signature, the piece that I do, like compose abroad. I think it's a nice gesture for the commissioner, and it's also, it reminds me pretty well the place I was working for a while. So the bagpipe was not specially recording for that project. It was a very old recording I have. I was recorded it for another project. Pierre-Alexandre was mentioning I was working for theater for quite a while. And that one was recorded for a piece by Arthur Miller, The Crucible, which takes place in the Boston area, and that implies Irish and Scottish people. So I recorded this bagpipe, and so this is, and the so it is an improvisation. It is not a piece of repertoire. It is an improvisation. I asked him to do something. The bagpipe player is not a an army like performer. He was an ancient music performer playing the bagpipes in the Renaissance and Middle Age repertoire. So I asked him just to improvise something, and this is what he did. So this is one of the two recordings I was using. And this is the pipcorn. So it is an old instrument made out of I don't know the word, la corne.
Horn.
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 Yes.
Okay. Horn.
Yes.
And so the instrument is very limited. It is essentially a dance music instrument of the Middle Age or the popular music. It has five notes, essentially. So just imagine the variety of the different melody you can make with that. So he did exactly that. He just did a kind of improvisation or something like that. And it sounds like this. Almost all the repertoire sounds like that. So this is it. So this is the two recordings I have. And then I was using a very simple technology, I would say, to work with that, just because I don't like that much to transform the sounds. I like to keep it as close as possible as the original. So essentially what I did is just I did two things. First thing is just to extend the duration of the sounds. And by analogy with natural languages, you see I said these notes split in consonant and vowels were then frozen with the bagpipes and also with the pipcorn. These instruments are wind instruments, and when the notes are attacked, they produce a lot of noise. And this noise could be associated naturally to consonants in the natural languages. Consonants are responsible for the articulation of the language, and consonants are made out of noise. They don't keep the trace of your specific phoneme system. And they are quite the same for everybody. But the vowels are the system part of the language. And this is where we recognize the sound of your voice, your imprint of your voice, which is unique to everybody. We have all a unique vocal imprint. So, and because I worked for many years on the cycle based on the voice, I was doing a lot of research about that. Working with that in my mind, so I just made the analogy with these sounds. Sounds that are more noisy are considered as consonant, and some sounds are more timbre or vowels. And then these freezed material. Are now split into different registers by a bandpass filter, and all these bandpass filters are sent to different speakers. This is basically the idea, and this is where when you fragment the sound like that into your speakers, I've done a lot of work that would usually destroy completely the sense of timbre of these instruments because they have been frozen, they have been split into different parts with different filters that breaks all the phase relationship, etc. But and then put it into different speakers, and then you listen to it and you recognize the bagpipe. Okay. So it sounds like this. Also, I start to introduce a bit part of the tools that we have created at the faculty for the years. And that yet was made in 2010. So we have developed at the time the first version of a plugin called Octogri, which is here. And it was a very simple thing. We built the Octophonic Studio at the faculty in 2004, and then we realized that we had no tools to make Octophonic. Considering the fact that most of the composers, especially at the bachelor level, most of the composers in electroacoustic music are working with audio sequencer, whatever it is. At the time, when we started the project in 2008, it was long before Reaper, I would say, there was no audio sequencers on the Macintosh, neither on the Windows platform, that would allow the users to do two things: to work in real octophony first, and to place the speaker wherever you like. There was one software at the time in the Windows world that allows the user to work in octophony, but the speakers were fixed. Okay, so you didn't have any flexibility about that. In the Macintosh world, just forget it, even today, except for Reaper. Reaper is since the version 4, where they have borrowed our code. The rule, open source software. So we built this piece of software, and we didn't build a piece of software. We did a piece of plugin, designed a plugin, precisely because we thought, okay, composers are working with audio sequencer, so they need a tool that would match or that would be integrated in their daily life. And they will be able to compose the space while they compose the time. Okay. So instead of developing a piece of software that will be completely separated outside of the audio sequencer, we built the plugin simply. We are now at the version, almost version 3, maybe this week. We'll see. And it has been a complexified. Very efficient, and now it's more elegant. It has more features, etc. But it works. So, yeah, you will see. So this is how it works. So you now hear one of the bagpipe filtered by the first bandpass filter, very narrow filter, which is specialized. Very simple gesture, and of course. Everything is here automated. Of course, we will hear only everything on the same speakers, but on the concert Saturday, you'll see that everything that I will show will come from a different set of speakers. And surprisingly also, a very simple gesture like this, which is very evident if you listen to it on 8 speakers. When you have everything working at the same time, it is not that obvious, which is fine from my point of view, because it is more subtle. One could imagine that, okay, he's playing with sound and making it working like that, yeah, come on. But it's more subtle than that. Filter 2. So second filter, frequency is kind of. The center frequency of the filters are based on the, of course, as you can imagine, on the analysis of the structure of the sound. So the center frequency is always placed where energy is the most interesting. So you see, there's not a lot of energy, of course, when you filter that much. So in different places in the work, the filters are a little bit larger, a little bit narrower. So it depends on different section. Thank you. Filter 3. So the bagpipes is interesting because the bagpipes has the drone, so it covers a lot. The register is quite large in the timbre of the bagpipes because of the drones. So it moves like that. And the next one. So we're now at 7
You see the eye, you hear the eye. Oops. Okay, so I just add a couple of things, as I mentioned, thunderstorm, rain, wind, percussion, and bass. And this is the beginning of, oops, this is the beginning of the work. So you hear the original melody at the beginning, which will be then omnipresent during the rest of the day. Acousmatic music could be a lot of different things, and there is a let's say a European tradition, let's say, where the works are finely crafted, very well articulated, with a lot of sound and music techniques, etc. Very good representative of this in this hall. Tendency this whole. This cycle of work has nothing to do with that. There's no articulation, no fragmentation. The discourse never stops. It's essentially immersive music. It is intended, Pierre-Alexandre mentioned the word deep listening, you know, the concept put in place by Paulina Liveros in the 70s. It's kind of the same kind of work where you have to abandon yourself and enjoy the intrinsic nature of the sound. So I can imagine that it is not that a kind of music that pleases everybody. I have no problem with that. It's normal with every music. And when it is possible in concert, we will have to discuss about that at the concert next Saturday. But when it is possible, I try to avoid standard concert configuration, try to put some places where people can walk into the space, for example. So they make a live mix within the hall. And when you move into the space, you really hear the way the sound is mixed into the acoustical space. And I think it enhances the experience of the concert for that kind of music. Eden. It was made in 2003. It is a second piece of the cycle. say it's my greatest hit in the cycle so far. It has been played in front of a lot of different audiences, standard acoustic music concert or electronic genre, people, etc. And it always worked. The piece was based, another piece that I made, for which I made the music at first for a theater play. It's funny because the theater play and the concert piece were made absolutely on parallel. They were premiered the same night. The theater play in Canada and the concert piece in France. I was not on both places. I preferred to be at the concert premiere, so I missed theater premieres. It was based on a piece by Marguerite Duras, Les Dames du Cinéma. And essentially, the music I made for the theater play and music for the whole duration of the play, 1 hour and a half of music. And it was essentially loops. And the set was designed in such a way that we were looking at a film on the screen, so we have a 5.1 system, just like in film today. And so both things were made. Different themes. Marguerite Duras, a French writer, She was born in Indochine, which is the actual Vietnam, the south of Vietnam. South of Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos. This is one of the sound sources that I was using for the theater, and then I use it in the concert piece. And then different themes. The Eden Cinema theater play was talking about her mother playing the piano in the 30s in silent film cinemas. So I reduced this information to two. The sea, because the story is about her mother being framed by the French government. They were selling lands that were inundated,
submerged
by the sea every single springtime. So it was impossible to grow anything because of the salt. So they spent a lot of money on buying the lands, and then they were ruined. And nobody would like to buy the land again. So all these families in the 30s and 40s were sent to ruin, to bankruptcy, essentially. Janice Ball's reference to The Lover, if you know another book by Marguerite Duras called The Lover, from which a famous film was shot. And The Lover was Janice. And finally, a rhythm that was omnipresent during the theater play, because they were always dreaming of leaving. Escaping, you know, so they want to go away, but they stay there, but they try from time to time to escape, but then they come back, and they try to escape, and they come back, so it's a nightmare. This piece is a nightmare, so I hope that my music is not a nightmare. So contrary to the other different works I've done, there is no progression, less progression in this work than the others. It starts from the beginning and it lasts for 18 minutes, and at the end it ends, because we are at the end of the work. So, except that there are different sections, and the different sections are shorter and shorter, and then expand again to the end. Very simple thing. And this is just to give you an idea of the beginning of the work.
บ้านในหนองน้ำใสเกิดบัวใบในตม เป็นสนมตรมยาแต่เป็นดอกภูผาปริศนาหน้าดูยามเมื่อเสาตรูหมู่แมงแสวงภัยโอ้ดอกบัวทองเป็นเจ้าของของภัย
French, we have a famous palindrome called made by Georges Perec, a French writer of the 60s, 70s, and he was able to make a palindrome of 1,800 words. Can you imagine a text made out of 1,800 words that reads the same in both directions? I can't imagine how someone is able to do that. For me to imagine, it makes sense. It's not only sense. It's a story that is absurd, but it is good French. So I was always intricated by that kind of mental disease or performance by anybody. So I did a piece called Palindrome, and it is a palindrome. It is a palindrome, it is a piece that could be read in one direction or the opposite direction, it is the same work. Okay. And not only it is the same work, but it is every single aspect of the song, of the piece, is actually readable in both directions with the same meaning. Okay. So there is no sound type like okay. Sound that could be very easily identified as reverse sound. There's no reverse sound. Every sound will craft from the beginning, from every single sample to the musical phrases, the general structure, the orchestration. I did only one thing. I did a vertical palindrome to have more fun to me. So it means that essentially we go from low frequency content to high frequency content in one direction and the opposite. So it's a reverse mix, which is also a palindrome. So this is the palindrome. I'm not quite sure it's a good piece of music, though. But well, so this is the forward direction.
Forward and now backward.
piece is made out of 64 tracks, I think, something like that. So, and they are filtered. So here we start with the high frequency content, and then we'll add more and more of low frequency content over time. So the mix is reverse, one direction compared to the other. So, can you Cupel was made in the ZKM, and we'll just talk about that very briefly in a moment. It is in Germany, and they have installed since 2005 now. They have installed a 47 speaker dome, permanently installed, permanently playable, available for concert, performance, rehearsal, composing, etc. And they have also designed a piece of software called Zirconium to manage the sound. And in collaboration with them, we have designed another plugin that I won't show at the moment, but I will use it in concert to control the Zirconium. Again, this idea that Zirconium is an autonomous piece of software where that allows you to specialize the sound in the dome of speakers. And we have designed a plugin that controls the Zirconium. So again, this idea of being able to compose a space while you are working the composition. Okay. Just an excerpt. All the sounds were recorded over there. This is one of the squeaking doors of the big building. And the sound was made out of essentially the sound of the tramways in Karlsruhe. Who has a very, very specific sound. This one, every time that goes, it gets that kind of listening. And because half of the city is pedestrian, it's very easy to make very good recording of these tramways. And they are brand new tramways, they are very essentially silent, but with this sound. Of the cycle called Pluie Noire, Black Rains, also coming from a piece of theater, a piece called Blasted by Sarah Kane, maybe some of you know about it, that was presented in Montreal 2008. And she refers, it is a piece about, it was a theater piece, even if the country was not mentioned, it was a piece about the Bosnia. In the 90s. Very, very, very heavy theater play, I have to say. And there was no, contrary of a lot of things that I've done before, we had no music in the theater play except for section, well, time that separate the section where the author mentioned summer rain, fall rain, winter rain, spring rain, or whatever. So we thought at the beginning, like everybody probably would have thought of putting real rain. We tried it, we installed the old fittings, but finally we canceled it. And so I was responsible to evoke the rain. So that was essentially my role. For whatever reason, I chose the baritone saxophone as a sound source. And the music for the theater play, contrary to the others, the music for the theater is very close to the concert piece.
Thank you.
essentially people were trying to breathe into this theater play. So this was the idea of using that kind of song. And the last piece that I will present on the, in the concert is called La Part des Anges, The Angels Share. You probably know a lot about that here. Angel Share is the part of the alcohol that goes through the barrels, and that is dedicated to the angels, especially when you produce whiskey, that kind of strong alcohol. And so in that piece, what I was trying to do is to do something like that, with a cappella song that comes from different music across the centuries and across the world. So essentially, the sound material is vocal, accompanied with different things. So, about the tools, because I think gears and gizmo, you know. But we need tools, and we still continue the development of the two tools that we have developed so far. And our project is actually to merge everything in one tool, in one plugin, which means that we will be able, if it works, and we are working now on that, to do. Because the first tool that we developed, the first one I showed you, was designed to make to work in octophony, which is in a 2D mode with no height. The ZOSC depends on the zirconium, but it works on a dome speaker, very specific speaker configuration. And you have to have a dome to work with it. So what we would like to do is to merge all these tools all together in such a way that composers will be allowed to do sound spatialization in 2D, 3D, symmetric or asymmetric speaker configuration. So if it works, I'll come back in 4 years to present the result, because it is quite a complex task. So we'll see. We were successful recently to make two pieces of software that works only in stereo, Ableton Live and Pro Tools Native, to work in multiphony. Okay, so we broke their incapacity of doing multi-channel works. But we haven't tested that much yet, so it's not public. we know it works. So if we are successful, then it will. The goal will be to just to offer the composers a general tool that will satisfy every possibility. We will implement ambisonic and VPAP, plus the VPAP and the natural standard panoramization thing. And of course, we hope to have more works. This year, for the first time, we had a student who made two pieces for the Dome of Speaker, which means that, in my opinion, it means that the tools are mature enough see an undergrad student making a piece for a dome of speakers, because it is possible to work at home with headphones. We have a HRTF simulation mode, so it's possible to do it with the headphones and then to come to the faculty and then to test it on real speakers. But essentially the work was tools are quite solid and strong to be able to use them anywhere. And maybe in the future we'll have our own personal tone speakers. Thank you.